In the case of a hypoxic crew on Malaysia 370, this is my scenario. They were at an altitude of 35,000 feet, and the period of high workload was over. I believe at this time, the captain left the cockpit. He could have been going to the bathroom. Certainly understandable. He'd been in his chair for 3 hours. He was a man in his 50s, probably had a cup of coffee. We can excuse him for going to the bathroom. I think wherever he was not in the cockpit. And at that time, the first officer was in command of the aircraft. I think there was a sudden decompression. The oxygen canisters for that flight had just been topped off and then reinstalled. And I'm not going to go into the details about how that can actually cause complications. That's in my book, and you have to buy my book. But suffice to say that there's reason to believe after the servicing of crew oxygen canisters, there can sometimes be complications with getting enough oxygen to the masks. If Farik was not getting 100% oxygen, pushing oxygen into his lungs, he would not be getting sufficient oxygen to make an intelligent decision. When you have a pilot who is operating with very decreased mental capacity, he would have been trying to get back to something familiar, Kuala Lumpur, Penang, maybe Langkawi. But whatever he was thinking, it wasn't logical. All we know is the plane went off on a course that has no, that defies explanation, and then disappeared like a zombie flight into the South Indian Ocean. Sully and Jeff Skiles had an airplane that couldn't fly, and they found out where and how to put it down safely. The irony with Malaysia 370 is that the pilots couldn't think, if my scenario is correct, they couldn't think, but they had an airplane that could fly, and fly it did, into oblivion and into history. And God willing, someday, perhaps it will reveal its secrets in an ongoing journey to safer skies.